and gentlemen, you're listening to Health in Harlem here on WHCR 90.3 FM. We will be right back with our regular programming. Please just give us one more moment and Health in Harlem will be getting started. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, we will be right back with our regular programming. That's right, ladies and gentlemen, we were meant to live in peace and harmony. Welcome to another episode of Health in Harlem here on WHCR 90.3 FM, the voice of Harlem. And today we're very honored to have, honestly, the most motivating and influential physician that I've heard speak ever. We had the privilege of having him at Mentoring in Medicine's commencement. And when he started to tell his story, about half the room ended up bursting out in tears. So hopefully you share these emotions and tears that he had to go through himself. And hopefully that motivates you guys to be able to keep striving to move on in your goals and achieve the unachievable, the dream that you have. And now without further ado, I would like to introduce Dr. Italo Brown, and I would appreciate if he could tell us a little bit about his background and what he is right now, and then we're going to get into how he became this person that he is now. So, Dr. Brown, thank you for joining us.
Thank you guys for having me. This is a pretty nice setup you guys got here.
Oh, thank you so much, man. Appreciate that.
And I just want to commend you all for having such an outlet. I can't think of any time in my young age where I listened to the radio and I got something more than just music. I got a form of healing, and I learned about different career options and more importantly, how connected the two are, you know, how you can listen to music and you can have an experience that leads to healing. And I think that as a physician, I use those things a lot. I relate to messages in music, specifically messages of struggle, messages of triumph. And I think that that kind of mimics my route through medicine. It's interesting that, you know, you gave me, you said I brought people to tears. I never really even, I never thought of my wildest dreams that just sharing, you know, I wouldn't call it necessarily a testimony, but sharing my pathway into this amazing field would bring people to an emotional nexus. So it's weird sitting behind this microphone and sharing it with the audience. I guess you said just kind of like go in and
Tell us a little bit about what you've done, and then we'll keep them guessing in between the commercial break, trying to figure out how that all came about, and then we'll pick it up from there.
I got it. Well, my name is Italo. It's I don't know exactly which dialect. My parents told me they got it out of a book of West African names, and it means full of valor, which is really funny because my parents are from Detroit. I mean, we're several generations. American, so I don't know how they got that creative, but full of valor, like bravery. So I guess it was my birthright to kind of have this certain type of courage and to walk this way. So at any rate, you know, I'm from Sacramento, California. One time I can't get the California out of me, and good. I mean, I can't get it out of me. I respect where I'm at, but California till I die. I came from a pretty good family. You know, my mom was a teacher, high school English teacher. She had me reading like Catcher in the Rye and Lord of the Flies at a young age. And my dad, he was a firefighter. He was the guy that ran into burning buildings when everybody ran out of them.
Yeah.
So you kind of smash those things together and you kind of see where the education piece and the desire to be a public servant kind of mash together. I wanted to initially just be a basketball player. And then I realized I wouldn't grow any taller. I was like, yeah, we're going to cap out right about 5'11". That's where it's going to end for you, brother. But I noticed that there was always somebody who could run onto the court and could sit courtside at every game and actually had something to add that was of value beyond just the skill of playing ball. And so I was like, all right, this doctor thing might be cool. Went through high school. It was a breeze for me. You know, I felt like, for the most part, I could look at material one time and then go take the test the next day and just crush the test. It was almost comical to me. It was like laughable to go into a test and feel nervous. I was like, man, this is nothing.
That must be nice.
That's what I say now. It must be nice. It was all that way until I got to college. You know, once you get to college, I mean, I went to Morehouse College in Atlanta, Georgia, and this is one of the premier campuses and universities in America, and I feel, or actually in the world, in my opinion, but it's competitive, and that's almost every college campus. Like, you have to eat your Wheaties to go to college. I didn't really understand that. I remember taking that first exam. I was in a biology class by Dr. McCray. It's an honors bio. I got served something fierce. Like, I literally studied. I studied so hard in my mind, which was actually like a day. I was like, that's longer than I've ever studied in my life. I went in there. It was guys who were studying like day and night, losing sleep, taking 5-hour energy type pill drinks and stuff. And we all got really bad grades. But my grade was extremely bad. It was like abysmal. I think I got like a 37 on my first test. Yeah, I was like, you know, it's nothing. You know, we fall down, but we get up. So I was like, let me go back to the drawing board. And this time I studied for our, like, midterm, maybe like 5 days.
Nice.
Yeah. I went and took the test again. I got like a 40. So it's like multiple L's just coming at me one after another. And I couldn't really understand where it came, like why I was not being successful like I was in high school. And it took me a long time to figure that out. What I'm getting at is there were several hurdles in that college space for me. I didn't graduate with my class. I failed a 1-hour physiology lab. And my whole family was down in Atlanta, Georgia. I mean, straight, ready to turn up. And I had to break the news to them that I'm not going to walk tomorrow. Wow. So that was a blow, to say the least. I had already been accepted to grad school, but this is like literally by the skin of my teeth. I think they just saw something in me when they came down to recruit, and were like, all right, just turn in your application and we'll get it going. So, I mean, I graduated college with a 2.7 GPA. My science GPA, I mean, I'm talking about 2.7, and that's with like art and weight training. Like the cheese, the gravy classes that will boost your grades. Yeah. But when you start to filter it down to those raw science courses, it was not a pretty look. And I was still hopeful. I felt like it was where I belonged in medicine, and that the ability to administer to someone's health, their mental, physical, and spiritual well-being, was it was a goal. So I just kept going down that pathway. But taking these exams you guys already know, it can be daunting. I remember studying for the MCAT. The first time I took the MCAT, it was a paper test. So for those of you that are familiar, this is like the equalizer in terms of taking admissions exams. I took it on paper. I took it when it was like straight 8 hours with like another piece written in between. And I felt confident when I did it. Like I felt confident on those first two exams. Like I felt confident when it came down to these science courses. And I remember going to check my mailbox and getting the score report. And I thought it was cool. I was like, this is a 19. This is because I didn't even know what the top score was. I was like, that's close to 20. I was like, man, I got to be somewhere near the top. And I realized that at the time, you know, the scale was to 45, I believe. And you can kind of see how that played out. I remember there were times where I would laugh with other people and talking about studying just so I felt included, knowing that I was like fighting back tears, fighting back the hurt from underperforming and not really understanding why I was struggling. At first, it was just like an application thing. Like, all right, I'm not really putting my entire energy into studying. But then it was like, yo, I will study. I'll look at this book. And it felt like the book was just smiling and laughing back at me. I was like, all right, look now. This material has to make sense to somebody. And they'll say, oh, man, it was just on page 57. Didn't you read that? I was like, man, I... show me in the print. And then you ever done that thing where you highlight something and then you go highlight it again? It has about five different highlight colors on it. That was me. And it took several years in grad school to really understand that there was a central problem in how I learned. So I'm kind of compressing events, and I don't know what the time frame is, but I wanted to make sure that I gave certain things adequate energy. So the first thing I'd say was I needed to understand how people learn. You know, you have audio learners, you have visual learners, you have people who are bodily kinesthetic, meaning they have to move, they have to do things. Action helps them anchor memories. And you have individuals who literally use teaching aids, diagrams, things like that. People who have to do teach backs, talk backs, like they have to physically say the information for them to know that they remember it. Yeah. If you think about rappers, you know, some rappers have to write the verses down. Some rappers, they don't write anything down. They can just say it a few times and then it kind of catches and then they can spit the same verse. That's the same way the brain processes information. And I had to find a parallel for me. And I realized like later on in the process that I'm not a great reader. You know, I'm one of them dudes that when I was in high school, you know, if you'd have asked me to read in front of the class, I would be like, man, I'm hiding behind somebody's head. or you use the finger to read. I think I use a joke all the time about how I was a picture guy. I like to see visuals. Yeah. So when, as an adolescent, I was like a elementary school guy, you see these books with pictures, but as you get further and further along, the pictures start disappearing, and then it's like, yo, there's no more pictures in this book. What I'm supposed to do is like seven pages of straight text. So you have to create the pictures. And when I figured out how to convert what the words were saying into digestible pieces and then create a visual or a story around that, it started to transform the way that I learned. But that wasn't without significant bumps along the way. Yeah. So we're on time number one, took the MCAT, got the I think it was an 18 rather, not a 19. I took it again a year later, and I studied. I remember using the same material, being like, I'm going to focus this time. My focus just basically meant I'm going to go into a Starbucks and stay there for as long as I can last until I can't go. I took it again a year later for studying for a full year and got a 19, 1 point higher, still on the bottom of the totem pole. And this is where the seeds of depression start to set in, especially when you are used to being a performer, when you can deliver and you've seen yourself deliver. And you keep that same level of confidence, but the result just doesn't match. I began to be like, do I have a learning disability? I remember saying to myself, like, am I just, you know, clearly outmatched? Are they that good? You know, having those types of moments where you get palpitations around people because you don't know if you're even smart enough to be in the room. You know, I remember feeling that. And I write pretty pretty regularly about those experiences and feeling inadequate, and feeling it's almost like you didn't belong, but wondering, like, why are you even in a room in the first place? You know, like, someone obviously thought you were significant enough to be there. Are you disappointing them by not fulfilling the end of the bond? I mean, the goal, the deal rather.
And I'm sorry, I just had a question. Was that something that you've realized that you've inflicted upon yourself, those feelings, or is it more that you were kind of observing everyone and you were feeling it, whether or not it was being said?
I think it's a little bit of both. So we can be our own echo chambers when it comes to, like, feelings of depression and self-doubt. For example, everybody has done that thing where you go to a store, you get a shirt, you're like, I look good in this. And then you get home and you try that same shirt on, you're like, this shirt's terrible. And you're like, try to give it some time. You're like, I'll just try it on another time. And each time you put it back on, you're like, I hate this shirt. Yeah. But then why'd you spend money on it in the first place? You know, you're the echo chamber of those feelings at that moment. Yeah. And you probably look fine in that shirt. But you won't allow yourself to think that. The other side of the game is, you know, there's a very well documented or very well studied and researched thing called imposter syndrome. And this is where you constantly have feelings that you just don't belong, that you're inadequate, and you can't seem to make the connection for why you're in a specific space in the first place. And it is shown to tremendously affect people of color and women, which to me is like a no-brainer. Obviously, we're the most discriminated groups of people and happen to be in those spaces the least. You know, so you take those two things together and you put it in the mind of someone who is still trying to find their own voice, developing, you know, a young 20 something person who has already got insecurities that they're trying to filter through, who already has the pressures from, you know, wanting to be successful for their family, maybe even trying to carry a financial burden for a family, or even to the extent of, you know, pulling an entire generation out of poverty, or pulling a generation out of whatever that unsettled place is. So those pressures compound the issue. You know, so to answer your question, like I said, I think that it's a little bit of both, and I think I experienced the full spectrum of those things. It's interesting to say it now in retrospect, because at that time, you know, it's just question marks. It's almost like when you hear about toddlers and they're in those two-year-old phase, I think that's the right age, 2 years old, where they question everything. But their question is so innocent. It's so like, you know, why does this turn on? And then what does that do? But your question in your 20s is that on steroids. It's like, why is this not working? But I tried everything in my power to make it work. It used to work this way, and now it doesn't anymore. So I felt like there were answers I wasn't getting. And it's not that, I mean, most of this stuff was existential in the first place, but when you feel like you're screaming out for that insight, that guidance, and you don't have it, you eventually like turn inward, and you can become, you can implode to a degree. So between that second and third exam, I remember going through a specific phase where, you know, each day was just a struggle. You know, I ended up finishing my master's in public health, but I didn't feel accomplished. I remember being in graduation in the regalia and having the mortarboard on and feeling almost like I was a shell of myself. It's funny because I looked at the picture today. I was trying to find something to post on Instagram. Like, it's graduation time. You know, people are putting things out there. And I just looked at the pictures like, man, was I even here? Like, this memory is almost like a blur, because there was a deeper feeling that was occupying my entire mind and wouldn't allow me to see that as an accomplishment. So you go through those things, and it's supposed to make you stronger. And I kind of get into that pivot point. Is this a good place where I could keep rolling?
Yeah, we could take a short break, or if you want to keep going with the story.
I can roll.
All right, so let's keep rolling then, man. I don't want to cut you off.
Nah, I got juice, man. All right, so there was a person that pretty much salvaged my righteous mind. Aside from my parents, you know, there's a couple laughing moments in the studying part, and I'm going to just throw those in real quick. So right before I graduated, between my first and my second year of grad school, I got pulled out of class by the vice dean, or the associate dean of Boston University. And it's weird, you know, you think to yourself that there's only a specific time in life where you're supposed to be getting snatched out of a class. Mm-hmm. You're not supposed to be a grown adult as someone comes to and they're like, hey, you need to come out of class right now. Like, literally peek through the window, point at you, and be like, you. So that rocked me at the core. And so I go back to the classroom, I mean, to her office, and this is huge, like, straight Ivy League-looking office. Obvious, I mean, because it's in the Northeast, you know, everything is grand, and it's got, like, you know, big old dark oak and leather-bound chairs and stuff, and I'm sitting there and looking at her books. She's got more books than I've ever read in my life, and I keep thinking about me putting my finger up to the page, reading. So I'm like, how long would it take me to go through all of these books in here? Right. And she's got her, like, you know, awards on the wall and degrees and these nice, well-matted, finished degrees, and starting to feel a little intimidated, but more so concerned, like, am I about to get kicked out? Because my grades weren't that great. And so she just closed the door. And she asked me to close the door. I closed the door, click, click, boom. You know, I sit down, and she's like, Mr. Brown. And she takes her glasses off, which is weird. Whenever you see an older woman take her glasses off, it's not a good sign. You're about to get the truth, like the entire unadulterated truth. And so she served that up to me on a platter. She was like, Italo, what the F are you doing? And I was like, oh, like, ma'am, first of all, you are an adult. You're seasoned. You know, you're seasoned. Second of all, like, can you speak to me like this? So she just, like, I was in that shock factor was like, you know, being in a shower and then all of a sudden it turns into cold water because someone flushes the toilet or something. Mm-hmm. And so she got my attention and she just literally went off, was like, you don't even realize your own potential. You're squandering it. She was like, I've watched you. You don't see me watching you. You go to these classes. You literally just float through them. And you've got so much to offer. And then she starts running my resume. Like, resume since birth type resume. Like, she had a whole squad of people. Almost the same way Pusha did Drake. Like, just have a whole team of people
ready
that just had your information and then run your resume. And she was telling me things about myself that I had forgotten. You know, like, prior accomplishments. The talents, things that you know, awards I got in, like, high school and things. And she was like, all of this. And then she went through, like, my family stuff and basically concluded at saying, I'm going to give you a second opportunity. She said, I'm going to give you a scholarship, retroactive and proactive. So it was like a partial scholarship for my first year there and then a full scholarship, academic scholarship for my second year there, and was like, here's the end of the bargain. you need to pretty much be a beast out here and show us that, you know, we made a good investment in you. She sat down, made a schedule with me. She taught me how to sleep, like things that you just don't even think about. She was like, look, you need lights out at 11 every night. Wow. I was like, man, what? I do my best thinking at like 1 in the morning. She was like, not anymore. You know, so, but really just took that time and put in the sweat equity with me and taught me how to recalibrate myself as a student. And after that, I just did well in every class. I felt like somebody needed me to be great.
Yeah.
And that's a profound feeling. Mm-hmm. You know, from beating yourself up and being your punching bag to saying, you know what, I got to train. You know, I need to go out there and give every single effort. I need to give every single thing maximum effort. You know, so it turned out for the better. I still studied for this MCAT. The next time, the third time, I only studied for 2 months. And my score jumped by 10 points. Wow. Yeah, so it was a pretty significant shift. It didn't make things easier, but it was the Flintstone striking that started to kind of like make this fire that I once had rekindle and then start to like blow. And then the people around me became the bellows. Like, you know, friends were like, hey, man, you still studying? Yeah, man. He's like, get it. Nah, don't come out tonight. Mm-hmm. You know,
nice.
I remember one time I was studying, man, my pops, I called my mom because I had done like a block of questions and I sucked. You know, everybody that's a student that's doing like questions, you had this period where like you just start hitting one question wrong, then the next question wrong, and then it becomes this like snowball of wrongness. Mm-hmm. So I called for a break and I was expecting to get my mom on the phone. So I answered. He answered, like, hello. I was like, hey Dad. He was like, what's up, son? How you doing? How's the car? Because Dad's always ask about the car. That's like the first thing they ask. How's the car? You eating? You know, stuff like that. You know, stuff like that. I was like, I'm good, man. I'm studying. And he goes, you know, that's all right. You know, just make sure you do your best. And I told him I was struggling. And I kind of just thought he was giving me the opportunity to unload. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, you know, I'm studying. I'm doing wrong on these questions. And I can't seem to get things right. Da, 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 da. I'm so frustrated. Ah. And mm-hmm. he just, like, stopped. He was like, son, I ran into burning buildings for 30 years. All you have to do is sit inside one and read. Mm-hmm. And then in a moment, it just like put everything in perspective for me and it shut me up. And I just like remember saying, can you please put mom on the phone? Please, Dad, just put mom on the phone. I didn't call for this tough love. I was trying to get the, hey, baby. Right. It's going to be okay, baby. Come here. You know, you wanted mama's bosom, and I got Dad's, like, the iron fist and velvet glove approach, you know. So, at any rate. But, yeah, so, like, those stories always give me a little bit of a reminder of how that time period was when the pivot happened. I took all those things. I got better scores. I had a better GPA in grad school. It helped my science GPA a little bit. I applied to medical school once, and this was, like, the most broad shotgun approach of applying. Like, I didn't even look at the books. I just said, you know what? If it's a school and I can make the money, I'm going to apply. So I applied to maybe 67, 68 schools. I got immediate rejections from, like, six of them, seven of them, like that. And then there were several, like, secondary applications and stuff. And it kind of frustrated me because it's a money game at that point. It's like, mm-hmm. yo, you can apply to as many as you possibly can afford. Yeah. But I had front-loaded because at this point I was like, you know, I had a second job. I was working a primary job as a researcher, and I had some disposable income. Mm-hmm. So I applied to all of them or did all the secondaries. And I'm a writer, so that's my bread and butter. I'm like, man, put it in front of me. I could write you something mm-hmm. compelling. And I was thinking to myself it was going to be the hook, line, and sinker, and then slowly rejection. I don't know if you've ever gone on a vacation and come back to see your email, and it's like 30,000 emails that have been
Why is it always like that?
Yeah.
There's always bad news when you come back from vacation.
And it goes back, and that's like, how it was. It was like, but except I wasn't on vacation. I was in real time. Right? I just look every day. It was like 15 messages, rejections. And you see those, it just starts to whittle back away at that confidence block of yours. Mm-hmm. So I just, I felt like it was a grand disaster. I picked myself back up. I called some of the schools. I was like, yo, what y'all need me to do to get better? They were like, all right, so maybe you can, you know, improve your scores or something like that. I didn't take the test again. I added some more community service, had somebody talk to me through. I applied to another set of schools the next year, like 50-something schools. Mm-hmm. Got 50 rejections again, second round, right? So this third round, I was like, I'm going to do something different.
Wait, and in none of these, you had no interviews, nothing?
Like, oh, no, you not really? A single one.
Wow.
Not a single interview. So at this point, two interview cycles, initially 63 rejection letters. The second cycle was like 50-something. And then no interviews, just secondaries. More money, mm-hmm. brokenness, mm-hmm. And still trying to, like, figure out how to get in.
So, like, what's going through your head at this moment? Like, that's insane. Like, I've still haven't applied a single time because I'm still in the punching bag stage, right?
And,
like,
right, right.
I can't imagine that I put my best out there twice.
Okay.
And then I'm still sitting there like, yo, what am I going to do now? Like,
nah, I got you. So, all right. The first thing was, you know, you have your moment of sheer, what's the word? Like, you are in denial at first. Like, nah, it can't be me. Maybe there's another one coming. And you just kind of, like, keep refreshing. You're like, it's going to be all right. It's going to be all right. It's going to be one in there, and it never comes, right? And then you get offended. You get angry, you know? So now I was mad. I was like, man, forget them. They don't know what they're missing or, you know. And someone else was like, dude, somebody in there is hating on me. Yeah. It turns into the world, like, conspiring against you.
Yeah.
And then you get logical. You're like, man, well, maybe they didn't pick me because of this. And you start trying to find all these other harebrained reasons for why they didn't pick you. Like, that's why, because I mailed it in the morning. I should have mailed it in the evening. like they probably got it after the deadline. Like, you start trying to rationalize everything. But it boils down to, you know, you sitting in a room and being like, all right, man, we got to start back over. Back to the drawing board, or let me figure out what I can do to improve. So I remember meeting with people. I met with multiple, I wouldn't call them guidance counselors, because at the degree, at the level of a medical school, they're like advisors or whatever. Mm-hmm. I remember sitting in the room with this guy. His name is John Polk. I don't want to name drop, but that's what his name was. That's what his name was. He became motivation for a while.
Nice.
I sat in his room, and he told me, it was like, he looked at my information, and I'm talking to him, and he's looking at the paper, and then, you know, when people look straight up at you without looking, like right over the edge of the paper,
yeah.
That's how it was. It's really kind of like a demeaning thing, but it's like, I'm reading, but I'm not really reading, and they look up at you, because it's like they run over something that's like, this ain't gonna fly. And I tried to talk my way out of it, and basically he was like, look, I'm gonna keep it real with you. You might want to look into being like a teacher or something. He was like, you're not going to be a doctor. Not with scores like this, not with this grades. You won't be accepted to a medical school. And he's like, there's nothing I can do for you. And that same conversation happened like 3 times. And it's like, yo, first of all, that's an extremely defeating thing to hear, is someone telling you to consider another entire career path. Although I understand why he said it, because in this climate where you need to continue forward movement, he wanted me to be real with myself and say, all right, what are the other options and other alternatives? Mm-hmm. But it wasn't phrased that way. And so I am very much so a fighter, and so it didn't make me feel like I could no longer compete, but I remember it like it was yesterday, how it came across and the cut of the words, and how immediately I felt as though I wanted to sink deeper into the chair and not even be there anymore.
Wow. You
know? So at any rate, like, those things happen multiple times for multiple people. So I'm just sharing that as like, this occurred in that phase.
Yeah.
But I looked at it as an opportunity to like strengthen these soft skills, things that I never really considered a strength, mm-hmm. you know, things that I did decently well, but never really turned into something active. So, you know, you guys go to the gym or whatever, and they talk about gains. They go, oh, you know, look at these gains. Mm-hmm. Gains ain't nothing but you finding something that you ain't never really worked out before and then really trying to create and sculpt that. Most people are like, oh, I'm going to do chest muscles or, mm-hmm. you know, thighs, whatever. And it's like, well, what about this one muscle here? And that's what separates those really good bodybuilders from just people who go to the gym, mm-hmm. is their gains are targeted around things that, you know, could go overlooked just as easily as anything else. Mm-hmm. But they decided to hone in on that. So I took that approach. And I just remember looking at things like how I spoke. There was one time where I remember I would quote things. Like, I love to quote rap songs. Like, I quote trap music to this day in talks. But at the time, it wasn't like trap music. It was just like Jeezy and Gucci. Yeah. But I quote music. And I was like, I really don't have profound quotes. Like, I can't. That helps you. That part of the art of speaking intelligibly is having, you know, being well-read. And having enough material to draw from and placing it at the right time so that it's surgical. Mm-hmm. And that was something that I wanted to work on. So I remember I would get around crowds and be nervous and talking. So I spent a lot of time thrusting myself into conversations. I read more than I'd ever read before. Like, things that had nothing to do with anything. And I was like, why am I reading, you know, books by authors that I don't even know this guy? Mm-hmm. Well, it was because I wanted to be able to relate to people. I wanted to create a stronger base of comparison or references, rather. The other thing that I remembered was, so if I'm going to be a writer, if I have to write all these things, I have to figure out how to do this faster. You know, I started writing like prompts and just mm-hmm. having prompts ready, like storylines, being like, you know, okay, my father, I remember when I would be like, my father once told me to run with blinders on, and talk about horses. I would say these horse races, they have blinders on the sides of their eyes, and it's to keep them from being distracted when they're running the races of their lives. Mm-hmm. And that's how mm-hmm. you get your Kentucky Derby champions. That's how you get your Triple Crown champions, is because they've practiced running for so long with these blinders on that they stay focused on that specific race. And then I would branch out and talk about how something in my life was like that, or using a poem. Like, so I started to build these things because I wanted, by the time the paperwork came across the table and was like, you're going to apply, I wanted to have it already mentally there. Mm-hmm. And then just literally copy, paste, drag and drop. So those things became like my focus. I said, I can control this. You know, I can build a brand around Italo Brown, the applicant, future doctor. that became the motivation. And that was literally what helped me to rebrand and repackage my confidence. Before, it was confidence out of ability, confidence out of, you know, excelling in whatever I did. And then it was like, now it's confidence born out of hard work, strategy, sweat equity, you know, being the person who was awake when everyone else was asleep, trying to figure out how to make something powerful happen. Because I understood the end game was, there are patients that need me. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I kind of owe you guys the reprise, and then we'll go into whatever else you're going to talk about. So, third time I applied, a lot less schools, like 20-something schools. I had the money for that. I was like, mm-hmm. you guys, you got me twice. This last time, no, I'm about to take this and go get these J's. Right. At least I'm going to apply comfortable. You know, I'm going to be in some J's and the application's going to be in. You know, because yeah. I knew that, you know, the University of Random Middle of Nowhere America didn't really want me as an applicant. I applied to those schools. I got like maybe 13 secondaries back. I responded. And then I had like these ongoing back and forth conversations. If you're ever in the interview cycle, I mean, not the interview, but the process of application, you know that these emails, these chain emails, these thread emails are like a huge part. And I kept trying to finesse this secretary. I was like, please just slide my stuff on in. Mm-hmm. And all I remember was, she was like, I'm sorry, we are closed for interviews this season. I've tried everything. I'm so sorry. If you apply again next year, I guarantee you're going to get an interview. And it's just like, you hear that, it's kind of, oh, okay, thank you, you know, I appreciate you, you're sweet, and that's what you want to say, but, yeah. You know, it still sucks. Mm-hmm. And I got an interview for a post-bac program. And I remember going to Georgetown. This is where the post-bac program was. It's called a GEMS program. Mm-hmm. Went there, tried to, you know, I went in and like it was a combine, mm-hmm. like the NFL combine. I was like, look, man, y'all want me, please take me, please. And unfortunately, they sent me back. It was like, look, man, you're a great applicant. Your personality is amazing. We can't take you right now. He's like, I'm willing to work with you over the whole year mm-hmm. to figure out what you need to do to get accepted. And so that was like the tides changed. At least people were acknowledging that, you know, you belong here. Mm-hmm. But there was still, you know, close but no, what is it? It just hadn't come to fruition yet. I boarded a plane to go to D.C. for a wedding. And I remember on this plane, I was in my own head. Most people, you get on planes, you start to do this, like, thinking. It creates this space for you to be like, oh, you know, let's reflect on life. And yeah. Something about being up in the sky mm-hmm. and closer to the space, closer to the sun than you've ever been, whatever. We hadn't got off the ground yet. So we were still on the ground, and I'm sitting there already going through everything. I'm unloading, man. I'm in the seat next to me. It's raining and stuff, and I didn't want the person next to me to see that I was, like, having one single tear coming from my eye. I literally was sitting on that plane like, please just keep going. And we taxied for about 30 minutes, and they made us get off the plane for some type of mechanical issue. As soon as I got off the plane, what do we normally do? Check our phones. You know, so I check my phone, and as soon as I turn it on, it just rings. And I'm like, that's odd. I answer the phone, and it's like a 615 number. That's a Nashville area code. So, you know, and I'm like, hello. And he says, this is Dean Williams. May I speak to Italo Brown? I was like, this is Italo. You know, because I had done my research. I knew who it was. I was trying to play it cool. I was like, all right, so what you going to say? Mm-hmm. You know, I'm trying to beat her to the punch. And she's like, you know, we rejected your application. I was like, oh, yeah, I remember. I was like, yeah, I know. Three times. But she was like, we have a post-bac program. There's an opportunity that's come up. And we have a space for one candidate. And if you're willing and interested, that opportunity is available to you. And I was like, before she finished, I was like, yeah, okay, I'm down. Mm-hmm. Like, yes, you know. And she was like, we start on Monday. And this is like a Thursday. This is a Thursday morning. She's like, we start Monday the next week. And I was like, I'll be there. And then we got off the phone, and I remember getting back on the plane, sitting next to my buddy, and I was like, dude, I think I just got into medical school. And, you know, in one of those, like, very weird kind of, not sublime, but surreal ways. Because I'm sitting in a chair, the same chair I was just in, and in my entire life changed. Mm-hmm. Like, completely shifted. Before, misery. Back on there, promise, providence. Like, all of it shifted. And in that moment, you take that one sigh, it's like the longest exhale ever. And in that exhale, what you're doing is relieving the years and years and years of built up, like, anxiety, stress, worry, fear, you know, all of those things. You're releasing it at once. And I remember just saying, like, man, it's gonna happen. So that was like the most remarkable thing that happened to me, like, in the educational journey, was just someone, simple words, just telling me, here's an opportunity. Do you want this? And me having to respond yes before she even finished the statement. So I moved down to Nashville with two bags. The following weekend, I quit my job. They were super supportive of me leaving. And I mean, if they weren't supportive, it was just going to be what it was. I'm sorry, y'all. I'm out. But lived in the dorms at Fisk University for 2 months, and just out of a suitcase and busting my tail. Eventually got the post-bac program fully paid for, like a scholarship. Some donor gave a scholarship to the school, and then they awarded a scholarship to me because of how hard I'd been working. And I kept telling the same story I'm telling y'all. Like, I've told this story so many times to people. And it's like, once you start to really break down these facets, people forget, you know, like,
this struggle is real. Like this, mm-hmm. this want and desire to keep going towards something that you feel like, I'm talking about like in your heart, to where you go to sleep at night and wake up and it's still on your mind and it haunts you almost. Like that want and desire to accomplish something, it converts people, you know. And it was a family, I think their mother had passed and left some money to the school, and someone was in within earshot of me telling this story, and then they were like, we want to give that guy the money, mm-hmm. you know. And it just kind of set the trend. I got into medical school the next year. I never failed another exam. Another serious exam. Never failed another standardized exam. I ended up becoming like a chief in anatomy, a chief TA. So now the guy who couldn't figure out how to learn is teaching everybody else how to learn. Mm-hmm. And of course, using my greatest strength, visual stuff. So anatomy was my thing. Mm-hmm. I got multiple scholarships. I ended up being able to get about maybe like 65% of my medical school career paid for. In my final year at Meharry Medical College, I got a full scholarship for that, for like just general leadership and excellence in terms of like how I performed in the classroom. I wasn't the top student, but if you look at the turnaround, you know, if you was in the NBA, it was the equivalent to saying the most improved player. Mm-hmm. That would have been my story, to where you become a vital piece of that institution. And yeah. Meharry really embraced me. They gave me every tool that I needed. I would say, you know what, I don't know how to get this information down. They were like, come to SEDS, which was like our tutoring center. Mm-hmm. And I became a devout student for tutoring, eventually became a tutor and recruited tutors. And it's, like I said, it just continued to shift everything. I matched successfully on the first time into one of the most competitive specialties. I'm in emergency medicine. And I'm training.
Congratulations.
I know. It was.
No, it's a long path.
It was necessary. And then I'm at a Jacoby and Montefiore up in the mm-hmm. Bronx, in one of the most unique health campuses, training in a community that is resource poor and so in need of seeing someone of color who can identify with struggle, who can identify with having not just dreams that have been deflated, but having to come back and figure out like what to do when everything is in rubble, you know. So those are what my patients are like, you know. I could tell you how many times I get the patient who's like, you know, I lost my job, my health insurance is gone, I haven't taken my diabetes medications in 2 months.
Wow.
Because I don't know how to pay for them.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And you can't sit there and judge them the way that I was judged multiple times. You have to be like, you know what, it's still possible. We'll figure out this. And even other things. I think one of the talks I've given, they ask me questions like, well, how do you think, you know, did having long hair and being black have anything to do with how hard your pathway was? I was like, I mean, obviously, yes, but it also has everything to do with why I overcame those things. And it has everything to do with why the patients that I see respond to me the way they are. So mm-hmm. I would be a fool to curse those things, you know, mm-hmm. be like, oh man, if I wasn't, you know, young black dude, I probably would be in medical school by now, or I'd probably be a doctor by now. No, I mean, that's why the pathway was what it was. Mm-hmm. Now, I do think that it's a shame and a travesty that getting people who are underrepresented minorities in medicine is a Herculean task. Like, why is it so difficult?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can start from anywhere. The tests are culturally biased. Yeah. You can say our understanding and exposure to medicine is very low. Like, how many of you guys had doctors that looked like you growing up? Probably very few. And you just go one after another, all these different things. But, you know, there's a researcher, her name is Angela Duckworth. She's out in, I think she's UPenn. She does this talk about grit. And this is the one thing that I think, if we could literally figure out how to make this a metric, mm-hmm. you would see that people who come from underserved backgrounds and minority backgrounds, we are off the chart in this area.
Hmm.
This factor of grit, like figuring out how to do something from absolutely nothing, how to how to take a situation that is designed for you to fail and not be successful and being like, you know what? I don't care. Mm-hmm. I'm about to ride this anyway. Like, just that idea of having a strength or an ability to just overcome despite, like, all odds, despite whatever's thrown in front of you, is almost intrinsic to this population of this populace. So,
because you've been doing it your whole life. Because
you've been doing it your whole entire life. Mm-hmm. Like, you don't really realize that that's what it is. Like, how many people are like, oh, you know, I've been taking care of my younger sisters, brothers, since I was little. I mean, these people are, like, bred to be caregivers. Or, you know, I've been dealing with a sick parent my entire life. Mm-hmm. Like, I know about grandparents' meds and making sure that she takes these medications on time. Or the fact that you have a grandmother and she speaks an entirely different language, and the medications, the labels are in English, and you've had to translate that since you were a kid to your grandma. Mm-hmm. Doesn't that just make you a little bit more apt to be in that space with patients who represent, like, the people who bear the major burden of illness in America are starting to look like us. They're starting to have multiple, you know, their backgrounds are diverse, and you have to have a medical system, or the healthcare system has to be flexible and conscious of that, and stop making it such a hurdle for people to get into this field. Mm-hmm. Especially if you want those culturally competent, linguistic appropriate care providers that, you know, the buzzwords make it seem like it's popular. It's like, oh, we want diversity in the workforce. Well, put your money where your mouth is. Mm-hmm. You know, start understanding that there are other things besides just, all right, so who scored the highest on the MCAT? Yeah. Does that translate into you having the greatest provider? Not necessarily. And looking at somebody's, you know, their resume and valuing service so low in comparison to things like, oh, this person, you know, went to a top school. Mm-hmm. Or this person, you know, like, how can you even compare the two experiences? You know, someone who, the way that we view medicine and looking to change the face of medicine. It's incredibly humbling to now be around so many people who see the necessity. And I surround myself with young folks who are trying to change that paradigm, who want to see us be in every aspect of society, because, you know, we realize that there is a gap and that there is a need. And that for me in medicine, you know, patients are legitimately dying because they don't have providers who understand them.
Wow.
So, I don't know, man. I'm trying to give perspective. I could talk more about what I've been doing or some of the things that I'm involved in, if you like.
So yeah, we only have a couple of about a minute or two left. Okay. on the program.
Sure thing.
So if you would be willing to come back another time, we'd love to yeah, no problem. Follow this up, man, because this is super important.
Yeah,
and,
no problem.
And what you've taken from this pain and struggle,
yeah,
and created with it is something that other people are also able to do.
Right.
And I think that you can encourage them to do so by showing them that it is possible and it's not a pipe dream.
Oh, no.
That, you know, it's not that, oh, with these grades, you'll never make it. It's not that, oh, if you want to be a doctor, you only practice medicine.
Right.
You know, you're taking the steps.
That's
to
right.
create the change that you want to see.
That's
and,
right.
I mean, we won't get more into the resume yet.
Yeah, yeah, no.
But for sure, if you would be willing to come back, I'd love to have you speak about it more. But just to wrap up this mm-hmm. show, what would you say? What kind of advice would you give to someone who's in this position right now, who's exactly where you are, who's angry at the system, and doesn't understand why they don't want them? Why are they being rejected over and over when they know that this is something that they want with all their heart, you know, where they know they're going to be a great physician.
Right.
But the path there is what's been holding them back.
Right. A while ago, I read an article that it was an interview that Will Smith was involved in. And he was like sitting courtside at a Philly at a basketball game. and they asked him some questions. And I remember this one specific quote. He was like, "You have to lean into the sharp edges until they no longer have power over you." And I thought that that was like a super simple statement. And you know, Will is like this young, kind of cool philosopher, thespian guy, but it was just so profound to me. And I think that that's what I would tell people, is like, think about those sharp edges, those things that are uncomfortable, those moments where you're literally at the bottom of everything. And you have to have the presence of mind to lean into that, because once you overcome it, it can never defeat you again. It can never have that type of control in your life or that type of pull over you again. And then you can convert that and wield it into something that is a strength. And I just call that a phoenix moment. Like when you live at the very bottom of whatever it is you're doing and you rise from that. But you have to go through the descent in order to appreciate what it's like to have that meteoric rise.
Wow, man. Thank you so much. I did tear up a little bit, but I made sure to dry it up before you caught me. But we on camera and stuff, you know. But thank you so much, Italo, for coming and, and sharing that story.
No, thank y'all for having me, man. I'll be back to talk to you guys again. It's been a pleasure, you guys.
Yeah, I'm only in my undergrad, but like, I don't know, after hearing this, I'm just like, yo, give me that MD. Like, there you go. I'm ready.
You got to be hungry, man. Go get it, man. Go get it. They're not going to give it to you. You're going to have to just take it from them.
Yeah, I mean, Sava over here, just actually, before we get off, I want to share her story a little bit. So the way that she just got off of the wait list and got
boom.
In is
boom.
by pushing through. And actually walking into the dean's office and saying, I want this.
That's what I'm talking about.
And this is, you know, I belong here. I want this. And she was able to change her mind.
It's that grit.
Yeah.
You have it was to something have that you've done before. You didn't push through to get some food. Yeah. I have a crowd full of people before. I know you know how to push through something. There we go. Ain't nothing wrong with that.
Amen. All right, brother. Thank you so much for coming through. And, hopefully next time we'll have Dr. Maurice Selby here. He's very excited to meet you. Unfortunately, he had a ER round that he couldn't get out of.
I get it.
So yeah, we'll definitely continue this next time. And up next you have Vinny B of the Vinny B Showcase. This has been an episode of Health in Harlem here on WHCR 90.3 FM. And this episode and the show is dedicated to the memory of Miss Gloria Thomas. Harlem, take care of yourself.